delivery models dot md. Now yesterday we have looked at a delivery model which was infrastructure as a service. In that, typically what happens is, okay, basically you will have the physical layers of your model which is controlled by cloud, and then we get a virtual operating system, and above virtual operating system, whatever we see is owned by us. Okay, I think I'll go back to that link. Yes, so if you see from OS, we are basically maintaining that. Okay, right, wonderful. Yeah. Okay, right, fine then. So let us get started with the next area of it, okay, which is platform as a service, or popularly called as PaaS. All right, so let us look into what happens in PaaS. Okay, so consider that your team is developing an application which works on Python, or which works on Java, or which works on .NET, right? So if you go with infrastructure as a service, typically what is that we end up doing? Okay, let me look at last images which I've used. Okay, yeah, okay. All right. So we will have, this is our cloud provider. Okay, sorry. This is our cloud provider, right? And the cloud provider will obviously have, okay, virtual machine, right? And if I want to work on an application which runs on Java, now what I get is an operating system. So I have to take this operating system. Okay, so let me also have a look at, yes, this is provider and this is consumer. Okay, so right, let me use a similar image so that we are in sync with whatever we are trying to do. Yeah, right. Now cloud consumer, okay, wants to run his application which is developed on let me call it as Java, right, or .NET, let it be anything, technology doesn't matter over here. So basically, if it is IaaS, infrastructure as a service, what he is supposed to do is, he is supposed to, okay, request for virtual machine. Okay, so he gets an request for virtual machine, he gets an access to virtual machine. Okay, and then in step three, okay, install necessary softwares or environments. This is the first thing. And then the fourth thing is deploy the application. Do you all agree with this? Okay, so let us assume that you want to run a website on infrastructure as a service, which is based out of Java, what you would typically do is you would go and request for a virtual machine, right? You get the virtual machine, you get an access, you get inside the virtual machine. So once you get inside the virtual machine, then what you typically do is you access that virtual machine, install the necessary softwares, deploy your application. Okay, right. And then whenever your application runs, it generates some data. You will have all of that coming into play. Are we clear on this? Any doubts or comments on this? Yes, good. So let me go to Cloud Essentials images. Okay. Cloud 15 dot. Right. So if we use infrastructure as a service to deploy the application, it would look as shown below, right? /cloud15.png. Right. Now, let me basically do this. Okay, so you want to run an application in Java. Okay, so generally what cloud does is, okay, cloud will internally create a virtual environment for you or virtual machine, right, which you don't worry about. And on top of this virtual machine, okay, within the cloud itself, they give you a ready-made environment. They give you a ready-made environment where Java is, let me not use this icon, let me use something which is, yeah. Java is already installed. Okay, and let us assume that you are running using Tomcat. Tomcat is a server which helps you in running Java based web applications. Tomcat is also pre-configured, ready made pre-configured environment. So as a user, you are not requesting for a virtual machine. You are request for pre-configured environments. Okay. So the user gets pre-configured environment, and the third option is deploy the application. So if you see, user over here in this case is not worrying about the underlying virtual machine. He is not worrying about what is the physical server or what is even the virtual server. What is he getting is he's getting ready-made pre-configured environments. Okay, so that pre-configured environment could be a database, it could be a technology, or it could be anything that your application runs on and your cloud provider supports. It could be anything that your application wants right? And everything what application wants might not be available. Okay, so but whatever your provider supports, but these days all the providers are supporting Docker as a technology there. So when you have a Docker there, typically you can run literally anything there. Okay, am I clear on this? So don't worry about a Docker over there. Over here, what is that you get? You get the pre-configured environments. There is no need for you to worry about operating system. There is no need for you to worry about installing the necessary softwares. Now let us go back to the image which I was showing you yesterday. Now, if you see, I'm not worrying about OS now. OS is managed with service provider or cloud provider. Middleware, which is the software which you install, runtime, the technology which you are basically working on, you will not worry about that. The only thing which you have to worry about, how to deploy the application and how to hold the data that your application is generating. Am I clear on this? Yeah, you obviously, you can select the versions also, but remember here the versions will be made available. You cannot go for a custom version. Your versions will be available and you have to use them itself. Yeah, okay. Does it make sense now? So are you understanding this model now? Right, here what is that you are getting? You are getting a platform and you can directly deploy your application onto that. Okay, right. So this is platform as a service. Do we understand this delivery model now? Yeah, you can every platform as a service is supporting Docker. So if your application can run on a Docker, directly deploy it over there. Nothing needs to be done is not a right statement. You need to do something from your application also. Sometimes your application might not work in that environment. You need to make certain changes. Okay, but here we get the environment, pre-configured environments. Okay, Vinith. So for example, if your application requires Oracle JDK version and Oracle JDK is not available, then it might not be suitable for you. That's how it works, right? But they give you pre-configured environments. Every cloud does that. Okay. I'm quite sure that some of you might have heard a term called as Pivotal Cloud Foundry or IBM Bluemix, right? So they are actually platform as a services. They are not infrastructure as a services, right? When it comes to AWS, when it comes to Azure, when it comes to Google, you can use them as infra as a service. You can use them at a platform as a service also. But Cloud Foundry is PaaS environment, platform as a service. Okay, if you have not heard about Cloud Foundry, it's okay. It's absolutely okay. Right. So in PaaS, okay, right? Ready-made platforms for running technologies, okay, like Java, .NET, Node, Python, etc., are made available. Users can directly request those environments. If you want customizations, some providers give the options and all providers support Docker as a platform. Okay, and all support Docker as a platform. Okay, so now deploying application on PaaS looks like below or is as shown below. So if your application is custom, generally people tend to go with Docker and they try to convert their application to be running on Docker technology. That's where Docker is very, very important. Okay, right. So some of the popular PaaS, okay, other than Google, AWS, and Azure, right? So we have something called as Pivotal, Cloud Foundry, and then we have something called as IBM's Bluemix. Okay, there are many other PaaS platforms. You can Google, you will find a hell lot of them. Okay, but I'm trying to tell that you might come across these things. So when you come across these things, you are basically dealing with this. Anyway, we know that we know about Azure, we know about Google Cloud, and we know about these clouds. These are popular ones, but sometimes you also come across these kind of things. Am I clear on this? Yes. That is an AWS product, right? So I'm not getting into the names of it. Okay, so AWS has something called as Elastic Beanstack. Azure has something called as Azure App Services and Azure Mobile Services. Google has something which they call it as, I don't remember the Google's name, but Google App Engine, if I'm not wrong. Yes, Google has something called as App Engine. Yeah. Okay then. Right. So then, typically PaaS as a platform is what your companies would like to use, right? So to develop their applications. Now the last delivery model, which is software as a service. Okay, so this is what your Google Cloud is, this is what your Google Drive is, this is what your Microsoft OneDrive is, right? So in this case, okay, generally for used for end users, okay, used by, okay, organizations building applications, all right, fine. Generally used by end users. Okay, let me take a scenario. Okay, so your organization XYZ has a payroll software which they run on premise. When I say on premise, what is it? It is your office's data center. Now, your organization has decided to run payroll on cloud to avoid hardware maintenance. They want it to be very simple. Okay, so now let's look at possible options. One is create virtual machines using IaaS and install or configure the necessary environments and deploy the application. This is one possible option. Second possible option is using PaaS. Okay, so deploy the application using PaaS delivery model. Okay, using a PaaS delivery model. Okay, if the necessary platform is available. Okay. And the third and the best option is if the software is already available as a service, then directly create it. So let me go to our own image. Okay. Now let me basically do this. Okay. So, right. So, consumer wants a payroll application. And I'm not sure how many of you know this organization of ADP. Okay. So now on your cloud, okay. So directly okay. ADP's product might be available on a service. Okay. Might be available as a service. Okay. So request for ADP software as a service. Now, if you see here, you are not worried about anything. You are directly asking for ADP. Okay. And access to the software is granted. So this will be as simple as you creating a Google Drive account. Okay. So this is the third option. Okay. As an end user, I would like to have this kind of a convenience. Or if I want to put it in this way, your companies are building your applications on the cloud so that it would be as simple as this for your customers. For your customers. All right. So cloud 70. Now this will be cloud 70. So if you see the difference in infrastructure as a service, we get the compute or you get the raw IT material, which is a storage or a network. In platform as a service, you get the platform. In SaaS, which is software as a service, you directly get the application. Right? Once you get the application, then you go and play around with your application, manage your application and all. ADP is company's name, sir. ADP is a company's name. Yeah. Any practical example of the deployment? I don't think so. I can show you that now, because if I want to show a practical application, then I have to basically go ahead and do either AWS or Azure, right? So which I don't want to, but right, if you want, we'll do one thing. We'll do that later next week, because we have some other things to understand today. Okay. Right. Okay. Right. What is payroll? Every month you are getting pay slips and all that stuff, right? Once you join your organization, there will be a software which can help you in managing that. That is called as payroll. Fine then. Am I clear on this? Do we understand these three delivery models now? Okay. No, Lambda is not SaaS. Office 365 is a SaaS. Yes. An operator have 2 million subscribers and they want to go to the cloud. Then what is the specification request to handle 2 million subscribers? Means who is going to compute how many virtual machines and softwares? Here your cloud engineers and your system architect will come into play and they will do an analysis and they will design an architecture. They will plan the whole migration, right? So for that, there is a whole migration kind of a use case which we need to. In terms of cost optimization, which is best? Okay, Flipkart is a SaaS to you. Okay, right? But we generally don't go and say create Flipkart, right? Okay, so Flipkart is directly something which we directly access. Okay, it might be on the SaaS, it might be anywhere, you are not worried about it, right? So you're directly accessing it. So from your perspective, it could be a SaaS, not from the perspective of Flipkart. Okay, so Flipkart is an application, right? So that's the reason why I'm not bringing it in. It might add confusion. Think of Google Cloud, Google Drive, which you create. Yeah, okay. Okay then. All right. So everyone clear about it? So we don't have any doubts on what SaaS, PaaS, or IaaS is. Yeah. So in clouds like AWS, Azure, and Google Cloud, they support all the three models. Right? They are not very great on SaaS, right? But they are definitely good on PaaS and infrastructure as a services. For example, Salesforce, right? So I'm quite sure that you might have heard a term called as Salesforce. Salesforce is a SaaS, right? Someone else runs the whole application for you. You directly get to access that. Am I clear on that? Okay, good. So now let us get into cloud deployment models. See, understand one thing. When I say cloud deployment models, you want to launch a cloud on your own, then what are the possible models? Okay, so as an organization, you want to start a cloud kind of an environment, then what are the models which you have? Okay, so here we have 4 deployment models are available. Okay, I'll write 3 men. The third one is very rarely used. The following, I'll name what is the other thing, right? Deployment models are popular. One is something called as public cloud. The second one is a private cloud. The third one is hybrid cloud. The fourth one is community cloud. I'm not speaking about that because it is not necessary. Very, very few percent. Less than 1% of our classroom also might not work there. So that's the reason why I'm not bringing that. Okay. So now what is a public cloud? Okay. By the way, our Amazon, Azure and Google, all of these three are public clouds, right? First thing of a public cloud is, okay, it is a publicly accessible cloud environment owned by a third party provider. In our case, the third party is Microsoft or Amazon or Google. Okay, am I clear on this? And public cloud doesn't mean that it has to be only infrastructure. It can be a PaaS cloud also, it can be a SaaS cloud also, whatever it is. But whenever a cloud is open to all, okay, so when I say open to all, not in terms of security risk, sir. So for example, Google is open to all. You also can go and create a Google mail account, and I also can go and create a Gmail account. It doesn't mean that Google is unsecure, is not a secure method, but it is accessible to everyone. That is the first property. Okay, and then here provider is responsible for creation, okay, of the resources requested by user. So for example, if you are creating a VM, the provider is generally responsible for that. Okay, am I clear on this? Okay, fine then. There are many organizations who are basically in this public cloud space, right? So to name the popular ones, right? Let me write popular players over here. The first one is, man, popular players, Amazon with its cloud platform, which we call as AWS, right? Microsoft with its cloud platform called as Azure. Google with its cloud platform, which is called as Google Compute Engine. Am I clear on this? Yeah. So, and generally, public cloud can be used in any, or can be provider can use one or all of the delivery models, right? So for example, Salesforce is also a public cloud, okay, but he is not giving you infrastructure. What he does is he tries to give you the direct application, Salesforce application as such. Okay, so understand one thing, and here generally, okay, in majority of the cases, public clouds are multi-tenant, okay, but remember, they do support single tenancy also. So what are the properties of public cloud? Public cloud is basically available to all the public. Anyone can use it, okay, right? And public cloud is generally, environment is owned by a third party provider. For example, Microsoft owns Azure, so all the servers that are present in Azure data centers are owned by Microsoft. All the servers that are present in AWS are owned by Amazon. Okay, they will be owning it. You and me will be basically placing a request, which Amazon or whoever the provider is responsible for creating it. Okay, and sometimes maintaining it also. I have not written maintaining it. Okay, and generally, all the public clouds, especially on the infrastructure layers, right, are multi-tenant. If you remember yesterday, we have discussed about what a multi-tenancy is. Am I clear on this? Yes, it could be ServiceNow also, right? But ServiceNow, if it is hosted by ServiceNow, if your company is installing ServiceNow in their environments, no, then that doesn't fall under that category. Yeah. Okay, then let me speak about the next cloud. Private cloud, okay, generally owned by a single organization. So for example, all the banks have their own private clouds, right, created for using cloud computing technology for providing IT resources to the organization. Okay. Right. Fine. Okay. Now, in this case, same organization is consumer and provider. In the earlier case, consumer was different and provider was different. In the case of private cloud, both consumer and provider will be the same organization. There might be different teams in your company. There might be a different teams in your company. Am I clear on this? So the same organization is a provider and the same organization is a consumer. Okay. So to have a control, what generally organizations do is they create a different business unit for that. But that business unit belongs to your organization itself. Am I clear on this? Right? But remember, this is not a normal data center. You cannot call it as private cloud. So I have 10 systems in my office. Can I call them as private cloud? The answer is no. Right? So your application, or you can call it as a cloud when your application supports high availability. Okay. It has scalability. It has resiliency, it has multi-tenancy option, and it has all the cloud options which we basically speak of. Okay. So popular products for private cloud. Okay. The most popular one is OpenStack. Okay. Microsoft has came up with something called as Azure Stack also, and even VMware has some product line. Okay, but I'm not writing VMware because it can sound confusing. Okay, so OpenStack, whenever you come across a term OpenStack is generally used so that your organization can basically create a private cloud on its own. Okay, so all the banks are basically going with OpenStack environments. So that could be one possible motivation for you to learn something called as OpenStack. Am I clear on this? Yeah, private cloud is used for the IT resources of that organization itself. So for example, SBI might use a private cloud for creating the application like online SBI, and online SBI might be used by anyone. That is their end product. But hosting the application like online SBI will be basically done by can be done by your private cloud. Does Amazon is also private cloud because they run their own applications in their cloud? No, Amazon is not running own applications in their cloud because typically they are two different organizations, right? Okay. Amazon Web Services and the cloud, they fall under the same category. Okay. But right, Amazon has built the services which are publicly accessible to everyone, whereas private cloud will not be accessible to others, right? Yeah. Am I clear on this? Okay. And then hybrid cloud. Okay. Hybrid cloud is a cloud environment which is comprised of two or more deployment models. Okay. So for example, your company might be using some parts of your application on the public cloud and some parts of your application on a private cloud, some parts of your application on the public cloud and some parts in your local data centers. Whenever you have combination of these kind of stuffs, right? It is not completely public, it is not completely private, or it is not completely community. I'll tell what the community is. Okay, right? So that is basically what a hybrid cloud environment is. Hybrid cloud environment is whenever your organization is basically either public or private. Okay, that is not the case. Hybrid cloud is a case where it might be using more than one. So for example, your company is, let us assume that your company has a private cloud which is built on OpenStack, and there you have a database and you are running a website on Amazon cloud or Microsoft cloud, which is basically owned by other. Now you have two different clouds for deploying your application. Or these kind of deployments are generally considered to be hybrid cloud environments. Apart from that, there is one more model over there. Okay, so there is one thing called as virtual private cloud. Okay, so actually that is a public cloud, but on that public cloud they will give you their own, you can put something on your own. So I'm not getting into that, I don't want to confuse you, but there is something called as inter cloud also. So your company is running applications where some of the servers are in Amazon, some are in Google, and some are in Microsoft clouds, right? So even that is possible. Those are basically being possible. Okay, so cloud deployment models: public cloud, private cloud, and a hybrid cloud. Okay, public cloud and hybrid cloud are more popular, right? So at least in our courses we speak about them. Our course is not about private clouds. For example, when you learn Amazon and Azure, you don't get to learn private cloud in our courses. We learn about public cloud, and we might learn a little bit about hybrid cloud as well. Yes, SBI's internet banking. See, why are you worried about SBI's internet banking? Look at SBI as an organization. SBI is to run internet banking, which is an application that your company is trying to build. They need a lot of servers, right? To create those servers, they might go with two possible models. One is a public cloud, the other one is a private cloud. Okay, so at the end of the day, every company wants to expose their application to the customers, right? Just because you are using it will not become public. Yeah, okay. DigitalOcean is also a public cloud, right? Because it is openly available to you and me. You can also create an account, and I can also create an account over there. Yeah. Right. Okay. We cannot say AWS is a private cloud. If AWS is a private cloud, AWS should be accessible only to AWS. But is that the case? You can also create an AWS account. I can also create an AWS account. You can also host your applications into AWS, and I can also host my applications into AWS. Then how can we call it as private? Right? Private is generally when your company is maintaining their own clouds. Okay. Is networking in private clouds virtual in nature? They have both. They have both physical networking and virtual networking, because they have hardware as well as virtualizations, right? So you will have both. Am I clear on this? So now, do we understand delivery models and deployment models of the cloud? Okay. Is Microsoft providing Azure Stack service, that is offer from third party and not from the same organization? See, I'll not put it in that way. You can take Azure Stack. Okay, and you can install that in your organization's on-premises data centers, and that can help you in creating your own private cloud, and you can go move towards hybrid cloud. That's the whole agenda of Microsoft. Fine, guys. So I think we have discussed about a cloud for this whole week, right? Yeah.
Thanks for watching. For more videos, subscribe our channel and click on bell icon.